scratching in the sand. Shuffle your feet and spin like a tie. Shake, shake, shake the Georgia slide.
Five, 10, 15 hours of your love. Vatican, Tennessee. Hey everybody, we're back for another musical escapade with Eclectic American Roots. Today we're going to hear from quite a few saxophonists on this show, so settle back, have a cold one, and enjoy. You know, I played trumpet in high school, but it was always the saxophone section that had the coolest dudes, and for some reason, they got all the girls. So what makes the sax such a sexy instrument? It has nothing to do with Bill Clinton. It's been said that saxophone is contagious, but you don't have to wear a mask to enjoy it. Here's a brief history. The first saxophone was created in Belgium in 1840 by Adolf Sax. Yes, really, his name was Sax. He wanted a powerful instrument between the woodwind and the brass sections of the military bands, but he had no idea the controversy his invention would create 180 years later as a classical, jazz, and rock instrument. It's been both revered and reviled, starting with the Vatican, who banned it from all of its Catholic churches in 1914, saying it was a demonic instrument. And then when the Nazis took power in Germany, the saxophone had become a symbol of jazz music and totally intertwined with African American culture, therefore making it verboten. Even Stalin's Soviet Union persecuted the saxophone as the embodiment of bourgeois American imperialism. Back in the U.S., when jazz music arrived, the sax became a voice for Black American liberation. It was during that first half of the 20th century that the saxophone became associated with dance music and jazz, the reason for its present widespread popularity. For much of the 1920s and 30s, the instrument's reputation suffered because these new sounds caused an outraged response from the moral majority. Sound familiar? Trumpets, trombones, and piano were considered legit, based on their history, but the sax was singled out as the dominant reason for the decadence of jazz in America. When the saxophone first became popular, critics called it the devil's horn and thought that its low, seductive tones would cause young girls to behave immorally. The censors of the day claimed that the saxophone contributed to drug use and promiscuity, with authorities even claiming that a rise in crime was a result of the devil's horn. The sax's ability to moan with jazz rhythms created a purely sensual physical appeal, the very foundation of that salacious physical dancing. Today, the devil's horn has superseded the old front line of brass, strings, and keys, and is now the most universal symbol of jazz. Some of the most well-known names in the world of sax are John Coltrane, Charlie Parker, and Sonny Rollins. But not all the players are male. Here's a look at a young female sax player who started a major trend of women playing the saxophone. There are dozens more great sax sensations out there, and you will get to know six of them on our show today. In the 1920s world of jazz saxophone, the speakeasy was an underground escape to experience the music and the culture of the era. I want to introduce you to an exceptional musician who recreates that vintage atmosphere right here on Eclectic American Roots. Ladies and gentlemen, Obie Hughes of Ellington Hawk.
Hello, friends. Welcome. Come on in and fill your glass. Close those mother-loving eyes and try to let go of your daily worries. Take a trip with Ellington Hawk and imagine another place, another time, a time when men were men. When smoky after-hours clubs filled the air with whiskey-burnt hoodlums and free-living dolls. And from the dim-lit alleys of the city, the sounds of jumpin' jazz and raw blues could be heard above the roar of the local underground dice game. Welcome to the other side of the tracks. This is where we have chosen to live, breathe, and bleed. Please join us on our adventure as we escape from these troubled modern times. Hey everybody, Obie Hughes here, coming to you from my personal studio in Upland, California. It's about 40 miles east of LA. I'd like to first thank Christopher Burkhart and Stellar Productions for having me on this beautiful Roots music show featuring saxophone today. For those of you who don't know me, I'm an artist and saxophonist with about 25 years under my belt. So I stopped for a few years and I picked it up again when I was 20 years old. I joined my first band, called the Ravons. Ravons were kind of a big deal in the Inland Empire in the early 90s. This was pre-internet, of course. But from there, I did meet Aaron Diley, a piano man extraordinaire from Rumble King. I joined him and Scott Ramirez and Ulysses Gallegos and helped form the beginnings of Rumble King. I made my bones with these guys, man. We learned the business together. I spent about 21 years with Rumble King and the Fellows, and we played just about any gig you could imagine, you know, carrying that upright piano everywhere we went. We did, from roadhouses to Disneyland, back alley bars to amphitheaters. But anyway, I left California and Rumble King. I tried my luck in Austin, Texas. Things didn't quite work out as planned there in Austin, Texas, but I did manage to pick up some shows there, a few gigs, and sat in with a couple of good acts, great acts. Dale Watson, being one of them, was generous enough to welcome me to Austin. My first show in Austin was with Dale, and he invited me up on stage to do what I thought was going to be a couple of songs. It ended up being about a 45, 50 minute set. So very generous of Dale to bring me up for that. I also got a chance to sit in with a great soul, rhythm, and blues band called The Lost Counts at the Continental Club with my old pal Bobby Trimble on drums, formerly of Big Sandy. I got a call from piano man and entertainer Lance Lipinski one night, who had just started a tour with Reverend Horton Heat. And he said, "Hey man, what are you doing tomorrow night? You got anything going on?" I said, "What's going on?" So he told me he's got a show at the Observatory with the Reverend, if I could come down and do a song or two. So I did, showed up, met up with the guys there, had a real good time, great show, packed house at the Observatory in Santa Ana. Also, while I was at that show with the Reverend at the Observatory, I ran into Abby from Abby Girl and the Real Deal. And I had met her at Viva Las Vegas the year prior, and her and I got to talking. I told her I was back in town, I was available, and she said she might be looking for sax to add to her band, and we ended up doing that. So for the better part of 2019, I did quite a few shows with Abby Girl and the Real Deal. Ended up recording a record that she just released, I'm sure you all know, called Calling Me Home. And that was well received. She did so great. I'm very proud of Abby Girl, and the band is fantastic, all the guys. Also got a couple of nights in, with a band called the Moontones. A couple of good shows with them in 2019. I've got my own personal project I call Ellington Hawk. Ellington Hawk is more of an all-around artistic expression for me. Live performance or a bit of a throwback to vaudeville with a sense of drama and theater to it. Musically, it's evolving, but it started out kind of more like a rock and roll approach to jazz, blues, and folk. Kind of an interesting thing. And it's got a bit of Jack Kerouac influence lyrically. I released an album in 2018 while I was in Austin. I actually released my first album with that, called Beatnik Bound. It's Ellington Hawk Beatnik Bound. Anyway, that's me. That's what I've been up to. Once again, I'm Obie Hughes, and honored to be a part of the show. Currently in good company with my pals Mando Dorame and Marco Palos. And I'll sign off with that. Everyone, thanks so much for listening, and thanks for supporting the arts and independent music.
Music historian and roots music legend Big Sandy is back to showcase some vintage saxophone clips today. Can't wait to see what he has created for this episode. Big Sandy.
Thank you, Christopher. And welcome, music lovers, jazz aficionados, and to all who have fallen under the spell of the devil's horn. Big Sandy here. Today, my segments will be a little different than they usually are. It'll be the same sort of collection of vintage snips and clips, but woven together in a way that feels more to me like a jazz solo after hours. Let's take a little trip right now with Cannonball Adderley and John Coltrane. Two legends blowing the devil's horn.
This is my beat, the jazz beat. How'd you like to join me as I make the rounds? The world of jazz after hours.
As if to forget their troubles, New Yorkers are going crazy over the music called jazz. This strange music has been accused of everything, including the present decay in morality, the bad weather, and the desire of the women for vote.
One, two, one, two.
Thank you. saxophone players. I don't know what it is, but they just curdle me. All they have to do is play 8 bars or Come to Me, My Melancholy Baby, and my spine turns to custard. I get goose pimply all over, and I come to them.
John William Coltrane, Julian Edward Cannonball Adderley, neither one made it out of their 40s. The Devil's Horn. When I come back, the Rocking Brothers, Sonny Stitt, Stanley Turrentine, and Thou.
Welcome back, everybody. We're about to talk to the founder of the Royal Crown Review. I should say he's one of the founders. He is also the band leader for the Jennifer Keith Sextet, and he comes to us from Los Angeles. Please welcome to the show, Mando Dorame.
What's going on, guys? Nice to see you. Thanks for having me.
Always good to see you too, my friend. You are one of the busiest saxophone players in the business, and we appreciate you taking the time to be on our show today.
Anytime.
You know, when saxophone started in America in the early 1900s, saxophone was considered the devil's horn. Is that still in play today?
Well, if you play it right, it is. That's for sure. It always was a carnival instrument at time. Back then, it wasn't taken serious. I mean, it wasn't in the orchestra. But it certainly was the the best instrument for rock and roll and rhythm and blues and jazz. I mean, it's the closest thing to the male voice. So, yeah, it's definitely made its mark.
Well, you certainly capture a lot of that devilishness when you play. Back to Royal Crown Review. I know when you guys had a very long and productive career, and a lot of people don't know it, that you were in that movie called Mask, and were actually part of the soundtrack. What was that like?
Yeah, it was a trip, man. I mean, it was cool. You know, I never thought I'd see Jim Carrey in a yellow zoot suit. You know, that was pretty bizarre. You know, especially going back from, you know, learning about the heritage and the history of the zoot suit with my folks who were from Watts. And, you know, to be able to take part in that and play that song with that, you know, kind of meaning and to have the heritage. My grandfather used to have a lot of zoot suiter friends of his, and were definitely around, you know, during that time, during the 40s, during the blackouts, of course. Living in Watts. So it was probably the only time that we ever got political in the band was with that song. So, you know, to see Jim Carrey go out there and put a zoot suit on and do what he did was pretty bizarre, man. But he's great, and it was fun. It was so much fun doing it, you know.
And what was the name of the song he danced with Cameron Diaz behind?
That was Hey Pachuco.
Oh, yeah.
And it was written for the Zoot Suit Riots in Los Angeles.
How many zoot suits do you own, Mando?
Well, I don't know if I can fit into them now. I mean, I probably held on to a couple of them. You got to be skinny to get in those things sometimes, at least mine.
That's great. What do you think? Can we play a clip of this, soundtrack from Mask?
Yeah, man, here it is.
Let's rock this joint.
So a lot of people have a lot of different influences that brought them to the world of saxophone. What were yours?
Well, certainly Big J. McNeely was one of my big influences. Bill Doggett was a huge influence of mine. He had a tune that they wrote in about 55 called Honky Tonk. And it was a solo by Clifford Scott, the tenor saxophone player. And when I heard it, it just resonated with me so deeply. If you don't know it, actually, I can play it for you real quick. I'll play you the head of it. It goes like this.
Okay. Wow.
So,
that's cool.
That was probably the biggest instrumental hit of all time. It was popular in 55. And, I mean, I wanted that tone so bad, so I worked really hard on listening to Bill Doggett and Clifford Scott and Percy France and those cats. I got to play with Big J. McNeely when I was about 15 years old in Whittier. I'm from Watts. My whole family's from Watts. My dad was a saxophone player, and he went to school at Jordan in Watts, and which is right in the heart of Watts, right by the Watts Towers, right next to the Jordan Downs Projects. And he went to school there in around 55, 56. And Big J. McNeely was, I mean, he was like a king in that town. There used to be this place It's called the Barrel House Club. And my grandfather used to go there and get drunk listening to Big J. This was like in the late 40s. And my dad used to tell me it was real muddy trying to go there. You'd have to walk through there and get full of mud just to get in there. And my grandfather would be in there listening to Big J, getting drunk. They had to call my parents, call my dad to tell him to come get him out of there. So my dad got to hear a glimpse of Big J. And when he was going to school, he would like to walk down the alley because he knew that Big J lived there. And he could hear him practicing sometimes out the window. So he knew he wanted to play saxophone, primarily because of Big J living in Watts. When I was a kid, I would jump on his lap about 4 years old, and he'd pick the saxophone up and he'd blow it, and I'd try to finger the keys and figure it out. And it was pretty awesome. But it was because of Big J. And I wrote a song actually about being in Watts and living in Watts. So it was practically across the street from my grandparents' house where they lived. And so, that's what they did. They went there and my dad wasn't old enough yet, but my grandfather certainly was there. And he used to tell us stories about being there and hearing Big J and how important Big J was. And when you listen to his music, you realize, I got a chance to study with Palos Johnson, who he was like the sound of the Pink Panther. He recorded the Pink Panther. He was Henry Mancini's right-hand man, his secret weapon. And so I got to study with him, and he used to tell me that Big J. McNeely taught everybody, taught him, taught Lee Allen. And I think you have the culmination of Big J. McNeely and the Watts sound, because it certainly had a sound there in Watts. I mean, you couldn't even go into Watts. I mean, the cops wouldn't even go into Watts. So they were kind of doing their own thing there, like at the Barrel House and stuff. And Johnny Otis was there. And so they had their own thing, their own way of doing things, their way of fixing their cars, their way of dressing. They had a certain pride of being in Watts back then in the 50s. And so it was such a thing that I think is very important for rock and roll. And then the whole Louisiana thing, that I think those two together is so big with regards to where rock and roll came from. And Illinois Jacquet coming from Louisiana was probably one of my other influences. But, Big J taught everybody how to swing. He taught everybody how to play. If you were a saxophone player, you can hear a lot of Big J and a lot of these people. And you can hear Illinois Jacquet and Big J's playing. So there used to be the Red Car, which is a train that used to go through Watts. It was called the Watts Local. And even though it was spelled local, L-O-C-A-L, the neighborhood had a whole other meaning. They called it the Watts L-O-C-O. That's what they thought it was, because it was a crazy train that ran through there. And my dad used to take that train, and they even hijacked that train a couple times. And so I wrote this song with my dad and with Eddie Nichols in Royal Crown Review. It's called The Watts Local, and it talks all about the neighborhood. Here it is.
Thank you.
Wow, Mondo, that was cool. Royal Crown Review was really swinging and smoking there.
Yeah. Hey,
is it true that Big J McNeely used to actually, during his show, lay on his back and play the sax for like a half an hour straight?
Oh, yeah, man. You know, I mean, that was the Watts teenage hop right there. I mean, that's what he did. I mean, he was the teenage hop. I mean, all these teenage kids would go crazy. White kids, they would go crazy seeing this cat do what he did. And man, I only wish I could have been there to see that, because only thing I got are the stories. I mean, at least I got some good stories from family that got to see that in Watts at the time. And man, from what I hear, you can't even describe what went down when Big J would play. Lee Allen was another great guy that just, man, I mean, he could play jazz, he can play blues, he can swing, he had played rock and roll. He was on a lot of those studio cuts. I remember him doing, Walking with Mr. Lee and Hot Rod Special, which is a tune that I like to play. I'm very happy that the Blasters put me in there so I can kind of get some of them ghost feelings from Lee Allen, maybe, you know.
Yeah, it wasn't 2 years ago we had you sitting in with the Blasters at the Yost Theater.
That's right. Well, yeah, man, you were there. You were with me, and I tell you, man, it was quite an honor. Those guys are the real deal where I come from. Yeah, I mean, I can. I mean, you know, talking about Illinois Jaquette, you know, he was very important because, you know, I think if you ever want to, you know, I was saying that, you know, the saxophone is very much like close to the male human voice. And I think Illinois Jaquette has the tone of the saxophone. He used to play a song called Flying Home that Big J McNeely recorded, and obviously inspired Big J McNeely. You know, this is the beginning of breaking down the bands and, you know, small band scene. In 1942, he recorded this tune, Flying Home, and Illinois Jaquette played this solo that forever lives in every saxophone player, in every saxophone player's heart that came after him. And it was a very memorable solo that everyone has copped from, and it goes something like this.
That horn, that is salty and sultry.
There's so much stuff in there. There's so much stuff in there that we've all borrowed from, stolen from. It's all in there, man. And that solo, you know, you got to check it out. If you don't know Flying Home,
that's great.
If you don't know Illinois' version, I mean, you know, Big J's got his version out there. Of course, it's bad, but make sure you check out Illinois' version, because that's where it all came from.
Nice. Well, thanks so much for sharing all this with us today. I wonder if we can go out maybe with a Jennifer Keith number.
Yeah, here's the thing. We used to play the Cosmopolitan in Vegas for about 2.5 years with the sextet. Man, they really loved her out there. And so we had a band together. We still do. It's called the Jennifer Keith Sextet. And We have so much fun in that band. You'll see us hopefully soon again out there. Maybe we'll be at your spot hopefully soon. And here's a tune that we played at the Cosmopolitan we actually have here. And it's, what is this tune? When I Get Low, I Get High.
Oh, I love that one.
And yeah, man, everybody loves this tune. Here's our version of it. We hope you dig it. And hope to see you next time.
All right. Thanks, Mondo.
Right now.
Now we welcome our friends from Steamer's Jazz at Jack's. If anyone can tell us why saxophone music is so sexy, it's these two. Please welcome our friends, Terrence Love and Tony Guerrero with Grace Kelly.
Saxophonist Grace Kelly has been making a name for herself since before she was a teenager. Her first album, Dreaming, was released when she was just 12 years old, and since then she's been earning fans worldwide and accolades including being named three times as Jazz Artist of the Year by the Boston Music Awards, numerous ASCAP Young Composer Awards, Alto Saxophonist of the Year by the 2016 New York City Jazz Fans Decision Award, and Downbeat's 2016 Rising Star Critics Poll. She's performed around the globe, including venues like the Kennedy Center, with artists like Dee Dee Bridgewater, Terry Lynn Carrington, Esperanza Spalding, Phil Woods, Wynton Marsalis, and the Jazz at Lincoln Center Orchestra. Grace is not only at home in the smooth jazz world, but she keeps great company in the straight-ahead jazz market, having collaborated on albums with legends like Lee Konitz and Phil Woods. She is also active in film and TV, and is a regular feature with Jon Batiste on The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. Please welcome Grace Kelly to Steamer's Jazz at Jack's.
Hey, Tony, what's up, man?
Hey, Terrence, look who's with us.
I know, Grace Kelly. Wow, what a pleasure. And it's a pleasure to meet you, Grace.
Nice to meet you, too.
Good to see you again. Where are you visiting us from right now?
I am residing at home in New York City. And yeah, home, it's been the most amount of time I've been all these last enjoying, you know, sleeping in my same bed every night. But yeah.
Now, you haven't been in New York City the whole time, right? That I've known you.
I think when we first met, I was living in LA. I want to almost say it was like 3 or 4 years ago. I got a call to join Jon Batiste in the house band for The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. It was only supposed to be a 2-week stint, and it ended up being half the year of their first year. And at that point, it was just like, well, this feels like my creative home. And I was like,
good.
All right, I'm going to be here for now.
Yeah, that's so great. First time I tuned in and happened to, I didn't know you had gotten that gig, and just to see you on there, I was like, that's Grace. Look at her doing that. Yeah, it's awesome.
Cool.
Congrats on that. It was awesome.
It was so fun.
Grace, whenever your name comes up, I tell people that I met you first at the KSBR birthday bash, and which is kind of known as, you know, it was, the music wasn't limited to this, but it was mostly a lot of the smooth jazz artists, and you've certainly had a home in that world. But whenever your name comes up, I always tell people that musically you stretch way beyond that, and you're one of the few people that does that scene, but is also well respected and making a mark in the straight ahead scene as well.
Yeah.
Tell me what's going on. I know more about what's going on with you in the smooth jazz world, but what are you doing in the straight ahead world?
Yeah. Thanks.
I mean, nobody's doing anything right now, but I mean,
yeah. I mean, you know, my background was learning jazz tradition and bebop to study, and my mentors, Phil Woods, Lee Konitz, Frank Morgan, that taught me more when we were on stage together and with our sounds intertwined than than I ever could have imagined in a whole education.
Did you say Phil Woods?
Yeah.
Oh, God. Phil Woods.
We not only made a record together called Man with the Hat with Monty Alexander on piano and an all-star cast, but he toured with me and my band. We played the Montreal Jazz Fest, Newport Jazz Festival. We were in Germany eating schnitzel together, him telling me stories about Charlie Parker and blueberry pie and loaning his sax, Charlie Parker. And I'm forever so grateful for those incredible moments.
Phil Woods has always kind of been like a hero to me. I was an alto player primarily. And I think when I heard Monk at Town Hall, Little Rudy Tootie, Phil Woods' solo on that was like, I said, that can't be a saxophone. It was like the most incredible thing I ever heard. And I just fell in love with him, you know?
Yeah. Oh my gosh. I know. Yeah. And some of the moments that we made music together too, it's like, I remember when we were making that record, actually, you know, the record with Phil, he would do one take. And it was just like, are you kidding me? That was really a masterpiece. Same with working with Lee Konitz. It's just like,
oh yeah,
one take. And it was, I mean, and rip Lee Konitz, one of the greatest improvisers in my opinion, the saxophone of all time.
Now you also mentioned Frank Morgan. Did you get to play with Frank?
Frank was like my musical grandpa. I knew
he was.
Yeah, actually, George Cables is the one who initially introduced us. And in the last 2 years of his life, we really got to know each other. And he actually brought me to play at the Pabst Theater in Milwaukee. I played 10 nights with him at the Jazz Standard. It was so wild. And we used to call each other and talk every single day. And it was like this connection, not only this musical connection, but this like heart-to-heart connection. And at some point, he was just Grandpa Frank. And I don't know how I get goosebumps when I think about it, because I learned so much from him. And I'm actually in his – there's an incredible documentary about Frank called Sound of Redemption.
Oh, I haven't seen that.
Ron Carter, Delfeo Marcellus, Mark Gross. We pay tribute to Frank in San Quentin Prison.
You know, for those who don't know, because Phil Woods and I knew about your relationship with Phil and Lee. I didn't know so much about Frank, but that's awesome because he's one of my favorites. And a lot of the general audience doesn't know his name as much as the other guys because, you know, so much of his career was limited to just a few years because of he was in prison for 30 years, 27 years.
Yeah, 30 years.
Yeah. But when he got out, he just was able to kind of reconnect with his career and just made some beautiful records at that time.
Totally.
And one of my favorites, but unfortunately his name didn't get to where some of those other guys did, but I'd love to see that documentary though. I'll have to look for that.
Yeah, it's an amazing one.
9-9-53, Frank Gerald Morgan, arrested by San Francisco Police Department, charge unlawful use and addiction to the unlawful use of narcotics.
Frank was a bank robber.
He told me that he had stolen $1 million in a check kiting scheme. He was good at it.
We were all doing life on the installment plan. We were in and out, in and out, in and out.
The LA musicians used to dedicate late night jazz shows to the greatest living alto saxophone player in the world, Frank Morgan. But if you want to hear him, you got to go listen to the Warden's Band in San Quentin.
Musicians were so excited by this kid. He sounds like Charlie Parker, only look how young he is.
Frank said, "Daddy, Charlie Parker blessed my horn."
He made 10 albums. He was on various TV programs.
We were sitting on top of the world at that point. I mean, fame and fortune was at the door.
Then one day, he met up with a notorious villain posing as a good friend. His name, Heroin.
You have to care about yourself. You know, and I didn't think that I was worth very much.
This is a man you forgive and forgive and help and protect for as long as you live.
We're delighted that you could join us this evening for a special concert in honor of a man who once lived right here in San Quentin. His name was Frank Morgan.
Yeah, well, thank you for joining us. Again. We really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
Stay safe.
Right. See you soon.
If you're like me, you look forward to Big Sandy's weekly contributions to this program. Here's another one.
Thank you, Sir Burkhart. Big Sandy back. In this segment, we're going to be taking a look at two greats, Sonny Stitt and Stanley Turrentine. We'll also be taking a trip to Sesame Street and watching some hip movie clips. But first, let's get warmed up, like really warmed up, with the Rockin' Brothers. And take a peek behind the sun, blowing the devil's horn.
Thank you. Saxophone.
Thank you.
devil's horn indeed. Now, those were scenes from two movies, Two Late Blues and The Connection, both of them from 1961, and worth checking out if you get a chance. When I come back, we're going to pop into an all-night jam session with a hawk, Coleman Hawkins, as the roots of The Devil's Horn continues.
Hey, everybody, we are back. Our next guest, some of you may know as the Dean of the School of Performance Studies at the Musicians Institute in LA. Some of you may know him for his work with the great Duane Eddy. And some of you have probably danced to his sax music at a James Inveldt show or at a Stellar show. And others know him for his work with Joe Bonamassa, Los Straitjackets, Waddy Wachtel, Ricky Martin, and Rick Holmstrom. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Ron Dziubla.
Hello, everyone. Great to be here. Thanks for inviting me, Christopher. Happy to be here.
I couldn't do a show about saxophone without you.
Thank you. Thanks.
You know, the show is about, the part of the title is The Devil's Horn. And one of the things that I wanted to ask you about was, what, is there an equivalency between like 100 years ago when it was first introduced and the church elders and the mainstream media were really down on saxophone?
You know, I'd say it seems to me that whenever the saxophone is mentioned, it's everyone has a definite opinion on it, right? So it's never neutral. It's a very polarizing instrument. So whether it's whether they love it or they hate it, you know, it's one of the two. And I always find myself in a position where I'm if they hate it, I'm just going to do my best to have them love it, you know. I think there's a video I shared with you earlier where a show that I did with Duane Eddy about 10 years ago in London, and Jarvis Cocker, the great British rock star, rock impresario from Pulp, introduced me with one of the best things I ever heard was he didn't think much of the saxophone before that evening. So there was a convert, you know.
Well, I know saxophone can deliver a lot of different sounds and tones.
Yeah.
Give us a couple of examples.
I know a lot of players like to go to the technical with the saxophone, right? Because it's easy. It's easy to play with a ton of technique and a ton of notes. But that was never what drew me to the instrument. What drew me to the instrument was the animal side of it, you know, and then bringing the animal out of the saxophone and how the saxophone brings the animal out of the player. You know, it's those notes in between notes. This is my, you know, I'm going to play a little King Curtis riff here. This is a little soul twist. It's my go-to for the sound checks. Here you go.
That's really cool. Sharp-eyed viewers probably would have noticed that his cat leaped out of the photo when he started to play. Is your cat a fan?
None of these cats. We got a ton of cats here. There's none of them are fans of this. You know, cats are rock and roll animals. I don't get it, but they, you know, they book. I feed them and everything, you know, and they can't seem to be down with the saxophone. But there you go.
Who are some of the musicians that influenced you to get started with the saxophone?
My dad's a child of the 50s, so I heard 50s rock and roll all the time growing up. So before I even knew what it was, that's what it was. It was honky tonk, right? It was the Coasters. It was Shotgun. But the two main artists, the people that I look to as my main influences would be King Curtis and Jan Garbarek, who's an ECM artist and a European saxophonist. And they come from two very different genres, right? King Curtis is, I mean, you know, from his recordings and his work with Aretha Franklin, Soul Twist, Soul Serenade. But the things that those two artists have in common is just really big tenor sounds. And that's what, you know, moves me, is that huge tone, that sound that just fills up a room and just, you know, grabs everyone inside here and moves people. That's what attracted me to those artists.
What I'm really curious to hear more about, you had mentioned Dwayne Eddy earlier. Mm-hmm. How did you get involved with Dwayne Eddy, and how did you get such a great opportunity?
Well, that's all Deke Dickerson. I got to give it to Deke on that one. Because Deke managed to secure Dwayne to play one of his Guitar Geek festivals, right? But he wanted to use all local musicians, you know, his band, people, you know, his LA people. Dwayne wanted to bring his sax player. And I just don't think it was in the budget. So I got a call from Deke, and he said, "Hey, I got a great gig for you. You have to be in town. You have to be around. You have to do this." So I talked to him. And of course, you know, I grew up with Dwayne Eddy records in my, you know, in the house. My dad had all the records, you know. So I was like, I was psyched. I really took it as an opportunity to do some rock and roll study, because all that Dwayne Eddy saxophone work, I mean, Gil Bernal, Steve Douglas, right? Jim Horn, Plas Johnson. I mean, it's all textbook rock and roll saxophone. So I learned those solos note for note, and then I made them mine. And after we did the show, Dwayne said, "Hey, you know, I'm going to take you everywhere." That's just how it went, because he had just signed a management deal with a company in the UK. So that's when all the work started, you know, shortly after that festival. I mean, he had dates in London, at Royal Festival Hall, and years later it was Glastonbury. We played the Ponderosa Stomp in New Orleans, and so for a while there was quite a few Dwayne Eddy gigs.
Yeah.
Oh, it's like I said, it's just for a rock and roll tenor, what do you call it? The student of the art, you know, such as myself. It's a joy, complete joy.
You want to introduce this clip?
Yeah. We're talking about the same. This is from that night where I was talking about Jarvis Cocker, right? Jarvis Cocker was on it. It was at a place called the Clapham Grand in London. It was a Jack Daniel's birthday party. And his band, the band that Dwayne was using in England, was the band of a songwriter over there, Richard Hawley, who's a well-known artist in the UK. Jarvis Cocker was all there. Was other people on it. Ellie Goulding, the pop star, she opened up the show. She hadn't yet hit, right? So I loved it, because Ellie Goulding, I have a picture somewhere. It says Ellie Goulding, and then it was a road case that said a semi-pro gear or something like that. I don't know what that was all about, but it made me laugh. We at the end of the show, it was a great night, and it was just one of those really magical nights. And we were just trying to finish it up with Peter Gunn. And it was one of those rare occasions where you can actually feel the energy of the audience towards the end, where, as Dwayne said, it's like we actually raised the roof off the place, you know, with the energy and the rock and roll was so intense that you could feel at some point the audiences go, whoa, up, and you could feel it within the recording. So, yeah,
let's hear it right
now. Very proud of it.
Well, let's hear it right now.
All right. We'll be right back.
And that was Dwayne Eddy and Ron Dziubla doing Peter Gunn. Awesome stuff. Awesome stuff. What new projects have you got going on?
Well, I got to give you the full story, right? Because everyone's in the same boat, right? We're in this pandemic. And I actually put the horn away for 3 months. You know, it was in March. And I said, you know what? You know, minus a few sessions here and there, I did something at home for Joe B. And for my buddy La Bamba, a trombone player, the Conan show, La Bamba's calling me to do some stuff. So I do some sessions here, another producer friend, Scroat. But I put away for 3 months, right? And we're talking about the devil's horn. But after like a few months, I felt it. I started feeling it in here. I was like, ah, man, why, you know, I'm not feeling good. And I talked to a couple buddies, right? And it's like, well, yeah, we're all this. We're not playing. We're not doing our thing. I'm like, yeah, that's right. I'm not playing. So then it started calling me back. And it was really quiet until the end of the year. And after the first of the year, I guess, it, you know, things just are starting to happen. There's a record coming out by the guitarist and film composer Lyle Workman. He does all the music for the Judd Apatow films. And he's a great guitarist who's worked with Sting and Beck and Todd Rundgren. And he's got this record coming out that I played on that was one of the most difficult sessions I've ever been on with a whole host of the best LA musicians. And I can't wait to hear that. But all of that is to say, you know, I was trying to get away from the horn, and I guess the devil's horn was calling me back in, right? Because I was saying, okay, I forget about it. There's no music business. I'm just going to put it away for a while. But no, it's got its grips, and I'm back in it.
Well, rest assured, better times are coming, Ron.
Exactly.
Thanks for joining us, Ron. Ron Dziubla, everybody.
Christopher, thank you very much. Thanks, everyone. Devil's Horn, if you don't like the saxophone, let all of us win you over at sometime, right? Let's all do that for you. So, thank you.
Thank you. What do you say we get back to Big Sandy and see what he's been cooking up?
Thanks again, Christopher. And thank you for hanging out with us here today. Hope you're digging it. Some of you might remember the jazz trumpet episode that we did last year, in which we took a trip to an after-hours jam session to watch the great Roy Eldridge blow his horn. Well, we're going to go back to that same party, but with footage that you didn't get to see last time. We're going to watch before Roy showed up to the party and after. The last patrons have been cleared out of the club, and Coleman Hawkins has taken his horn out of the case and ready to soar.
Who just made the scene? Coleman Hawkins, a jazz pioneer of incomparable stature. The Hawk was the very first jazz man to attain fame on the tenor sax, and although his role has been challenged many times during the past 40 years, in our book, Coleman Hawkins is still the champ.
Do a little lover man there. About five, you know.
The doorman, and I think they have been moved a little. See what you think.
Devil blues.
the opening scene from the 1960 film Beat Girl, starring Jillian Hill, with music by the John Barry Seven. And in that scene, a very young Oliver Reed as the guy in the plaid shirt. Before that, we heard a little musical snippet from an Austin, Texas favorite, Ted Roddy, with his band from the 90s, The Naughty Ones. I'll be back in just a little bit as we continue to explore the roots of the Devil's Horn.
Let's return to Terrence and Tony from Steamer's Jazz at Jack's for an inside conversation with sensational saxist Jason Fabus.
Thank you. Jason Fabus is enjoying a wonderful journey as a highly sought-after professional saxophonist throughout Southern California. Jason is also a well-known songwriter, arranger, and producer under the name J-Fab, and has collaborated with numerous artists including Billy Davis Jr., Marilyn McCoo, Cameron Kinghorn, Bardo, and the Regiment Horns of the Tennessee Kids. Fabus is also an esteemed music educator, serving as a coach and clinician at several schools while maintaining his own studio of private students in saxophone, flute, clarinet, and piano. Although still early in his professional career, Jason has already performed with many notable musicians, including Arturo Sandoval, Jane Monheit, Kim Richmond, Wayne Bergeron, Andy Martin, and George Benson. He recently recorded saxophone on Panic at the Disco's new album Pray for the Wicked, The Simpsons, the Netflix Mystery Science Theater, DreamWorks Animation Trolls World Tour, and video games Fortnite. Steamers Jazz at Campus Jacks is proud to present Jason Fabus.
All right, we're back, and look who's with us. Welcome,
Jason Fabus, man. How you doing, buddy?
Lawrence and Tony, good to see you guys.
Good to see you too.
Man, you were swinging there.
Yeah, you've been on our list to get on this show for a while, and it just hadn't happened yet. But so I'm glad to have you here with us tonight. So.
Yeah, I've been a fan of it. I a lot of the people that you've had on are friends of mine. You know, we play together, and it's just good to see them doing their thing.
Where did that come from over the last 10 years to all of a sudden capture the attention of a bunch of the younger players?
I think it's definitely it wasn't like a shift where everybody was like, okay, let's just get into this style now. It's been like a transformation over the last few years. I know, like, personally, before coming out to California, I moved out here in 2012. I was going to school up in Minnesota, and I actually did a classical saxophone degree up there. Wow. But I was always just into kind of the Capitol era singers of like the late 50s. So like if I wasn't playing saxophone and I was just listening to music, it was usually like Frank or Nat King Cole or Sarah Vaughan or Mel Torme. And I got into like the string arrangements, like Nelson Riddle and Gordon Jenkins. And for some reason, that was just a sound that I liked. And what I didn't realize was that I was listening to tunes like Swanderful or On the Street Where You Live, or what the one that we just played, which was Them, Their Eyes. And like I was approaching these tunes from a context of late 50s, which is what I was into. So then as I move out to California, I start to meet some musicians, a very good buddy of mine, Gareth Price, actually. I have to give him credit because he was really into traditional music because he was working with a musician at Disneyland, Ralph Reynolds and John Reynolds. So it was kind of this mixture of me being into standards from the 50s, but then starting to meet the right people out here in California that were more about playing those tunes in the vernacular of the 1920s or 30s, where they came from. And then at the same point, like still trying to become a part of the scene out here, which is modern and is progressive. So like, it's just like this combination of trying to fit everything.
One of the reasons that I chose to open Steamers was that I was kind of a straight ahead guy. You know, I am, as Tony was saying, old, and I grew up and, you know, my father, you know, I listened to things like Al Hurt, Dexter Gordon, you know, Sonny Rollins, things like that. You know, that's where, and I'm a sax player, but not a professional, but that's what I did for many, many years. And when I, you know, one of the things I heard and when I opened up Steamers was in the midst of a lot of this contemporary jazz. And one of the things that I wanted to do was feature straight ahead stuff. So, you know, I got in, you know, Herb Geller from Germany. I got a lot of Lou Tabakin from New York. I brought in a lot of great players that were in that thing. Ernie Watts, and he was a little bit more contemporary, but he still, you know, Pete Chrislieb, all these cats. And that's what, you know, and I was like, you know, for me, listening to Dexter Gordon, you talked about melodies, do Society Red. You know, about a 5-minute solo of just repeated melodies that just continue to go. Not, you know, not shredding to the point of where you don't understand what he's doing, but it's all a melody. And that's where
Sonny Rollins would pick like obscure like show tunes from the 20s.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Like, you know, we're in the money or just random tunes, and then he would be free over it. But like, yeah.
Yeah, it's great to have you, and I'm definitely a fan of yours, and I do hope we can share a stage sometime soon.
Yeah, Terrence, Tony, and Tim, who's running everything, thank you for having me on, and let's please, when the time is right, I'd love to just sit down and chat more. We just barely scratched the surface, so.
Yeah, and again, thank you for being with us, and we'll hope to see you soon.
All right, guys.
Holiday, my friend.
Holidays. When snowflakes fall,
about to introduce to you somebody that started Fat Cat Swinger 18 years ago. He's also involved with the Louis Prima Jr. and the Witnesses, and this saxophone player has also been with the Rip 'Em Ups and is in the Viva Las Vegas house band. Let me introduce to you, please, Marco Palos.
Hey everybody, how you doing? Good to see you, Christopher.
Thanks for joining us today. I know that you've had a lot of projects going on in the past, and I know you've got some new ones that you're working on in the future.
Yes, sir. Quite a bit happening these days. I'm trying to make yourself as busy as possible, stay creative, and get through the days, you know, until the stages open up again.
And that's going to be a while. And I know that I can tell the audience that you're coming to us from a cabin deep outside New York City, north
that's
of New
right.
York City. What's that like?
It's been it's cold, but it's actually, you know, I got to say, it's funny. I've always said that there's a little bit of cold is different depending on where you're at. And a New York cold is quite different than a California cold. Now that I'm here, I've adjusted and it's fun. You know, got a beautiful view of the snow and the woods out here. And just, you know, it's 5 hours north of New York City. We're really kind of detached from everything, but it's been good to rest. It's been good to write some music. It's been good to play around on this old piano right here. Just a lot of good times.
You're working on some solo projects, and I want you to tell us a little bit about those.
Sure. Most folks that I've met in my saxophone career have known me through swing and jazz and R&B, doo-wop, a lot of that. But I've really played, I've never ventured off into some of the other original music that I've done, which is mostly kind of rock based. And so I've been doing a lot of that. I've got a couple of the songs will be including saxophone still, but I've only got a few more songs until I got a full album organized and ready, and that'll be it. Hopefully, my goal is to by May or June, hopefully have a full solo album out. It's one of those things as an artist, you kind of want to get things out that you've always wanted to do, but most of the time you've never had the time because you're too busy running from gig to gig. So with this downtime, it's really opened up the opportunity to do this. And so figured why not take advantage of it and just do it.
Yeah. Taking the year off really affects your schedule, doesn't it?
As I mentioned before, I don't know how easy it's going to be to try and get back into. I'm sure once we're into it again, maybe we'll get that energy from the audiences and the shows, but man, I'm so out of the rhythm of gigs and hotels and airports and everything that I'm just like, wow, what's it going to be like when we go back, you know?
People are really ready for some more live music. And I know that some of the stuff you've done in the past has been superb. I know you've got a lot of original material under your belt, and one of my favorites is a video called Blow. What's that all about?
Oh, man. So I've always wanted to have a music video that was going to be a cartoon. And I don't know if you know Marcus Howell. One day he was editing some cartoon video, and I said, where do you find that footage from? And he sent me to this website where you find some public domain cartoons. So I picked this one called Barnyard Bunk because it had these saxophone players in it. And what I did was I kind of repurposed the cartoon to go along with our song Blow. And Blow is the song I wrote. It was the last song written for the album Blow of Louis Prima Jr.'s second album. And I remember just coming into the studio the final day. We're like, all right, this is it. After this, we're going to Capitol Records. We're recording the album. And I came in. I said, I got one more song. I got this idea. And it ended up becoming the title track of the album, which was really cool. But I always wanted a cartoon video, so I just edited this together. And it's a blast. I had fun imagining as if it were a cartoon I had originally done.
Well, hey, everybody, bring the kids into the room because we're about to see a pretty cool video called Blow.
Hey, Marco.
Yep.
Why don't you play that number you've been working on, man?
All right.
Okay, everybody ready to go? I'm just going to blow.
So, Marco, I know your favorite instrument is the saxophone. What got you into that in the first place?
Well, to be honest, it was a crush I had on a girl in the fifth grade. I wanted to sit next to her. She played saxophone. And I go home and I tell mom and dad, I was like, you know, mom and dad, I'd love to play saxophone. They're like, oh, we can't afford one, but we'll save up if you really want to play. So I finally, it was about a year later, I'm now in the sixth grade. And I'm about 2 months behind the rest of the class. I had to play French horn temporarily just so that I could stay in band. And but my saxophone arrived and I started practicing and I started working really hard. Because ultimately, as a kid, my goal was to be in the class with this girl again who played saxophone. The seniors invited me into this little jam session they were doing they taught me my first blues scale, which it was the B flat blues scale. And they said, all right, just now play, use those notes and play. So I did. They go and they get me, they get the band director. They're like, check this out. And that was kind of the beginning of improvising and saxophone for me. And then he pulled me out of my English class, put me into the jazz band. And finally I caught up with the girl and we remained really good friends all this time. She's still a good friend of mine. But yeah, I always say that that's kind of what kickstarted my career in sax, was a crush on a girl. My mom, whenever we're driving places, road trips or anything, and we drove around quite a bit, visit family, always AM radio. And so I always got a kick out of the songs that we'd listen to. And as soon as I got my saxophone, I would just imitate what I heard. And it was mostly, you know, things that you would hear on AM radio. So that's kind of where I picked up the older vintage style. And that's kind of been my favorite thing since.
I think it's great. You've had a long career. You've got a long career ahead of you.
Thanks, sir.
What's another video you could introduce to us before we leave you?
So this is a video clip we found. I think it's a fan-made video of a compilation of all these different performances with Louis Prima Jr., which is pretty fun. That's, I think, where I get a lot of showcase time on the saxophone. And that's just been a lot of fun for me. So here's a little clip of multiple clips of Louis Prima Jr. and The Witnesses.
Sandy back. And in this, my final segment of the day, we're going to take a look first at saxophone in film, starting with the great film noir DOA, and then we're going to take a look at The Rat Race, starring Tony Curtis and Sam Butera, Louis Prima's sax man, as you'll see in the clip after that. Then we'll get some good gravy. But first, this. Yeah.
fisherman. Stay by the fisherman. Go on, go on, go on. Get it, fisherman.
Place you got here.
Will he hit the pitch in about an hour? That's when they really go out of their minds.
Who's the blonde?
Oh, she's one of the chicks that hangs around here. She's jive crazy.
Thank you.
Jackson, Mississippi, the wonderful Mr. Teddy Edwards, dishing out some good gravy, right out of his devil's horn. Okay, for this, my last clip of the day, I'd like to share something that's special to me, and something that I thought I'd never see. It's live footage of Big J. McNeely at the Rim Ram Club in Santa Fe Springs, California. It's from, I think, the very early 80s. Well, in 1970... my family and I lived right down the street from the Rim Ram. I heard stories about the wild shows that Big J. McNeely used to perform there. My mother saw him earlier than that. She would tell me stories about his flaming red hair and wild-eyed look on his face wailing away on the sax. And I always wanted to see what was going on behind those doors. I would stick my head in there sometimes, but it was before the action had really started. Now, recently, doing research for this show, I'm poking around the internet, and what do I find? I find this. It's the footage of Big J. McNeely in action at the Rim Ram.
We want everybody to let your hair down. If you can't let it down, take it off. And if you haven't got no wig at all, be cool, because we're going to blow our brains out. We're going to do a little thing called Big J. Shuffle. Honey, we want everybody to get on the floor and just take your time, though. Don't hurt yourself, children.
From the Rim Ram in Santa Fe Springs, California, Big J. McNeely with Big J's Shuffle, an important part of my childhood memories and an important man in the history of the roots of the Devil's Horn. All right, friends, thanks for stopping by today. Hope you've enjoyed the show, and if you have, please consider visiting the old tip jar. Thanks to all of our guests today. I think it was a good one. Y'all take care and beware. The Devil's Horn.
That's our show. It was all about the saxophone, so I guess you can say it really blows. Remember, we archive all our Eclectic American Roots shows on YouTube on the Stellar Jacks channel. Won't you please take a moment and drop a tip into the jar at stellarjacks.com? The money helps our musicians pay some bills and makes their ends meet while they're still out of work. Venmo is Jack's hideaway. Keep wearing those masks and distancing. We will all get over the stampanic quicker that way. So long for now, music lovers.